For more exclusive content, subscribe to all our social media platforms, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter. You can also find FanView Live on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and Stitcher.
Yo, yo, what's up? It's your boy Marlon, Big Favorite, and y'all are watching FanView Podcast. Hello, somebody.
Whoa, what's up, everybody? Y'all already know what it is. FanView Podcast. We're on episode 3, G-Sportz.
Episode 3, man.
Episode 3,
yeah, man. We're coming along.
Coming along.
Baby steps.
Baby steps.
Yeah.
First with Pokey Chapman. Then Mr. Jimmy Chase. Episode 3. The Westbank legend. Hello, somebody.
There it
is. Y'all already know what it is,
there
man.
It is. Listen,
Marlon Favorite is joining us for episode 3 of the FanView Podcast. Listen, welcome, Marlon.
Thanks for having me on, fellas. They say the third time the charm. Hello, somebody.
That's what I'm talking about.
Popping with it. Oh, yeah. We're going to have us a good time today.
We're going to have us a great time today, man.
Yeah.
Listen, me and G-Sportz and Coach Hurricane can't make it to here today, but, man, we sat down. We put down some list of people together, man. Trust me. Your name was on that list.
Definitely had him. I had him on the list.
I had him on the list.
Man, I just been impressed with your journey, man, from – I followed you through high school. I mean, I graduated 2003. You came out 04. I remember you being the number one player – number one D tucker in the country, playing on in the Army All American Bowl.
Right.
I followed you all through LSU. Your journey, the practice squads at all these different NFL teams. But what I want to talk about and get into on the podcast, you know, to start it off is how you was able to break that barrier of getting on national TV like NFL Network and just rubbing those elbows, man. Because everybody know it ain't easy to get on, especially a national televised show,
right,
as an African American.
It's tough. It is tough. How did I break that door down? Consistency.
Mm-hmm.
Before we went on, I was just talking to G-Sportz about how consistent you are with your brand as well.
Right.
Consistency guided reps. Reps really matter. And relationships. Now, yep. I'll pause right there and jump into what I mean by the relationships. Right when I felt I was going to retire from professional football, it's 2014, my last season with the Voodoo. So I announced the retirement in 2015, but I knew in my mind, like it was family life started to kick in, you know.
Right, yeah.
I started to, you know, those Marlins getting a little older, Trails getting older, so I had to really start buckling down because that wasn't really going anywhere, if you know what I mean.
Like, right.
You know how – when you're doing something, you feel like it's hitting that peak.
That plateau. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you plateau.
You're plateauing.
And, mm-hmm. and I felt that, and my family started to feel that, so it started to be a ripple effect, you know, throughout my whole deal. So what made things, where the relationship come into play at the time, our player personnel lady was Haley Asaro. You remember Haley, right?
Yeah, because I was with the organization.
That's right, Fred. You were. That was 13?
2013. I was with the Voodoo organization.
Damn, I forgot all about that. Fred was.
Forgot about that.
I was with the Voodoo organization.
Haley, my relationship with Haley got me in the door with Cox Sports.
Gotcha.
So that's what really started the consistency, the brand recognition, the reps, all the stuff that really matters to being a good broadcaster, being able to expand in our business.
Correct.
So I started at that level. And I remember Marcus Spears. He called me. I might have posted something on, like, Twitter or something, and Spears was like, "Fave, keep going. I like what you're doing." And I was like, "Man, let me hit you up. You still got to say, yeah, hit me up, big dog. Just give me a good." So, you know, I'm like, at that time, Spears just kicked the door open with SEC Network.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, these dudes are drafted NFL players
right.
who were actually getting reps in the NFL and starting right. and got, you know, had the juice. I knew it was going to be hard from the political end to get in because, A, I didn't have an agent. By the way, my agent is God. Still to this date, outside of my sports agent, Shea Ayabuzi, shout out to Shea, throughout my NFL journey and even UFL and a couple other gigs I had, mm-hmm. Shea held it down. But after that, it was God. And a team, right. family, right? Talk about Robin, talk about Nick, talk about my wife, Tanisha, just being able to keep the fort balance while I'm going through this haywire lifestyle, right?
Right, right. It changes.
It's 250 out the gate.
Yeah,
man. You know what I'm saying? Like a week.
Yeah.
And I got to travel to Lafayette. I got to travel to Lake Charles, Baton Rouge. But I couldn't look at the money. I had to look at the reps, the brand recognition,
right,
the being able to shake those hands, to be good for to walk in the store. And say, hey, man, you hello somebody. Like, all that started then in 2014.
Yeah.
Like, it didn't. You know, for y'all's listeners, the hello somebody's, you know, all that stuff ain't just starting.
Right.
Last week, you know, that's something that it took time, it took consistency. So kicking the door open and getting with Cox those first 3 years was the most important piece to it.
Did you know when you was at LSU or even in high school that you wanted to get into television or broadcasting of some sort? Like, did you know that, or that just kind of just came about when you was getting ready to retire and trying to figure out what you wanted to do with the rest of your life?
Good question. At that point, I was heavy sports music.
Right.
It was sports music, sports music.
Right.
So we were, I mean, shouts out to my cousin Daly. He actually produced my hit song, Hello Somebody. And he was doing those beats on garbage cans and pots that his mom was fussing at him for taking out the kitchen. So that started, that was my vision from Dump to be a sports guy. And to play and do music.
The music.
From Dump. You know, Fred can attest to that.
Yeah.
We've been since we hello.
Hello.
So at the very end of the day, that mattered. But it was my mother. Shouts out to my mama. She was like, oh, you're going to be on TV. Like, she just said it like that. Like,
she saw it.
She saw it. So that kind of.
Right.
You 16, 17 years old. I knew I wanted to be in business, and I knew I wanted to do something in sports and entertainment. That's always been my deal since the little one. So what ended up happening, my mama really started to push that, yeah, you're going to be on TV one day. So it was like, it was really her that birthed that vision initially. So I went on and took Mass Comm at LSU.
Okay,
And jumped into it from there. I took some improv. So I'm SAG as well. So I've started in a couple of movies as well.
Okay.
So that was always in me. I never was afraid to do work on the camera. I always had a thing for that since we were young.
Mm-hmm.
So it just came natural. LSU allowed me to take those courses and get the reps, public speaking and all.
Right,
like,
right.
All that stuff. So shouts out to the Tigers for that. And graduating and finishing school, which mattered. When I first got on the phone with Eric Coleman, who was the director, executive director for Cox out in the Baton Rouge office.
Mm-hmm.
One of the first questions he asked me, you want to guess? What he asked, on my job interview on the phone, what's the first question he asked?
How was your time at LSU?
Good question. You close. Want to take another stab? You're very close. How was my time at LSU? Did I
graduate?
That was the first question he asked. I confidently was able to say yes because I graduated.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That was important. Now, this 2014, I'm interviewing. I'm watching. It's me, and it's one of the stage producers who he was the play-by-play, and I was the color.
Mm-hmm.
So we did a half of football. In order for me to get to that, we did St. Aug versus Carr. It was like Speedy Noel, Leonard Fournette. Mm-hmm.
Big-time game.
They muted the game, and we had to call it. So that's how I auditioned for the
That was your first time ever doing it?
That was my first time ever doing that outside of LSU.
Oh, I know that was tough.
It's tough.
It wasn't. That was the crazy part. That's how I got hired so quick, because it happened fast. Because it was like, man, he took it naturally. So I took improv at LSU, of course. Reps on like Channel 4, Channel 6, like Doug Mouton and say, Marlon, want to come in and talk about the Saints? You know, the Saints won a Super Bowl. I was on with the Saints in 09.
Right.
So you still had 10, 11, 12, 13. For all them years, I'm still playing football. So I would go into four. So shouts out to my employer, WWL, because they really helped me get the reps with Doug in the beginning, and then that happened. But that was just game analysis. That wasn't play-by-play.
Right.
So it was, you know, we love football.
Right.
So I'm listening to the commentators, too. So that's how I kind of was able to pick up on
learn some different things in the trade, because understand, they're masters of their craft.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We don't really look at them a lot of times and say, man, you know, they just took on again. No, that's a business.
Right.
And that's a craft.
Right.
And some of those guys are real sharp in what they do. They may have not played the game before, but they're real sharp.
It's an art to it.
It's an art to what they do.
It's
an art. You're right. And that's what fueled it. That's what got me in the door. And then 3 years, and then, of course, LSU, and then everything else followed.
So how did you get on NFL Network? Because that got to be your biggest platform that you've ever been on.
That was my biggest platform, 9 segments, 6 days, sunny California.
That's tight.
Dream come true.
Yes, yes.
Like, I can remember watching.
They got you a merriment.
Let me make y'all laugh. I'm glad y'all said that. So the NFL Network sent me a list of days to pick out of. So I didn't want to go hammocks. I'm doing every day. I'm so excited to get the gig.
Yeah.
So the days that they wanted was at me and my wife's anniversary. Ooh. So one of the days that we went out there was May 27th.
Uh-huh.
So I'm like, man, well, babe, I'm going to just go after. She said, who going after? Well, you better get out there. Yeah, that's going to be our anniversary.
Sacrifice.
So what they did, like the NFL Network found that out in our production meeting before. So they found, it just so happened, me and Ndamukong Suh have the same, our family have the same weekend anniversary.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
So he was getting married. So it was like, that's not the only person in the studio celebrating. So they pulled up me and my wife's picture as well. Wow. So that, like, I think I got like 1,000 extra followers from on Twitter. From
Dang.
But I'm like, wow, that was creative for the folks from the production office to pick up on that. But my wife's like, oh, that was beautiful. Because, you know, we Skyped and all of that stuff or FaceTime. And,
yeah, yeah.
But, you know, I was out of town. I was in L.A. for our anniversary. So that was cool. But to how I got the gig, all right, so I tell people this all the time. Consistency matters.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to have a resume. Now, I'm a G, y'all break me up. I can run it. So that's one of my things. I don't mind hello somebody.
Right,
running
right,
it. So
right.
Pause me at any part of this, but I'm going to try to make a very long story short.
Right.
So, all right. I'm doing okay in broadcasting. I'm at LSU Sports Radio. Mm-hmm. I'm on with Gus. You know, everything is going the right way.
Right.
I feel like my career is trending in the right direction. And I didn't really want to rush that process.
Right.
So what I ended up doing was just chopping wood. It was my cousin, Nick, one day. I work out of their office. So I'm getting some stuff rolling. I'm rolling with this stuff. I'm like focusing on.
Right.
And he just kind of kept like bugging me about, nah, man, you got to go check this NFL broadcast boot camp thing. And I heard about it.
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, I'm going to go to that, but I'm not in a rush to get to that.
You're chopping wood. You're brand the foundation. You're brand the foundation.
Those things are going to come. And I'm going to get to that. So then the next day I come to the office, man, I'm telling you, you really need to do this, bro. I said, bro. And at the time I'm like, dude, you see I'm hustling right now. I just got a deal closed and –
Right,
you know,
right, right.
I know that's gonna cost. I don't have no money to spend on that right now, so I'm ignoring him. He kept bugging me. He said, "Man, look, man, I was praying last night." He's like, "Man, I was even saying my Hail Mary. Just fill the stuff out. Look, bro, just take." And that kind of caught my attention. I'm like, uh-huh. "All right, bro, whatever." So I put all that stuff to the side. I think I called Tennessee. I'm like, "You got to get tight today." So I focused. I filled out everything. Blah, 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 blah. So I filled it all out and I sent it. Got a text the next day. Congratulations from the NFL's from the Bridge of Success. I got an email. You made it to the NFL such and such. Your resume was yada, yada. You're invited to go to Bowling Green. So Bowling Green is important. That's where they hold a broadcast boot camp.
Come on. Really?
Right. Bowling Green, Ohio. So we flew into Detroit and we took a bus over to Bowling Green. Now, that's important.
And what year was this?
This was 2019.
2019.
That's very important because what's happened in 2020?
COVID.
Come on now.
Hello, somebody.
So hello, I was hello, somebody. Now, I'm trying to push this, Fred. I'm like, nah, I'm going to do
timing.
This. Nah, timing is everything. So that's the answer one part. The timing was right. And, like, Nick, like, nah, you got – because that's his deal. Like, man, I know this, bro. Like, I'm telling you. And he's been right before with things. So I wasn't super hesitant. Had another deal. I had to come off some money. Mm-hmm. I had to pay for the thing, so I had to pay my way. And I don't have the credited seasons of most of my NFLPA colleagues, so I won't get reimbursed.
Sacrifice.
So if I had sacrifice, so I go local New Orleans. So, like, you know, Skylar Green, you know, Robert Meacham, and not to tell these guys business, you know, Darrell Williams, and even now Leonard Fournette and all these guys,
correct.
They're now vested. So they've had over 3 years and 3 games with the NFL. Mm-hmm. So they actually – guys that's vested, you get reimbursed, not me.
Right.
Right.
I had to go high risk, high reward.
Right.
Right.
So that's another thing.
You bet it on yourself.
Bet it on myself. To the listeners, if something you won't do, go high risk, bet on yourself. trust that God put the right tools in you.
I didn't even think about it like that.
That's what I went, cuz. I had to go straight.
Wow.
High risk, high reward. So, you know, I got out there, and the biggest next hurdle was 36 NFL players, current and former. So it was like.
What you mean?
So
at the boot camp.
At the boot camp. So the whole goal is to get some gigs after the boot camp.
Gotcha.
So I knew Mark Sanchez was in that boot camp.
Mark was there. That shouts out to my homie Mark. Yeah,
come on, man.
Yeah. So Mark Sanchez was in that boot camp.
Mark was there. Vernon Davis was there.
Broadcasting one of the games now.
Right. You're right.
Yeah,
so
Matt Castle was there. Vernon Davis was there. You had some.
Vernon Davis trying to get in the broadcast.
Torrey Smith was there.
Wow. Torrey Smith from the Ravens.
Because what the broadcast boot camp does, guys who are wanting to transition from professional football into this profession. But I get to the meat of the story. When I got there in the first meeting, they had like a slide show up. So they had like different examples of us in the room on television. They put up a picture of me on TV. Shouts out to my homie Jerry, G-Mac. He was our coach there.
Mm-hmm.
Worked with ESPN for 20 years. Worked with the NFL for this broadcast deal. So he took my picture out of all 36 people and was like, now that's posture. Because, you know, I was, you know, doing our television thing, you know, shoulders up, confident, right.
Looking to the camera.
When he spotlighted me, why he did that? Vernon Davis, all them boys, everybody was following me. Everyone, man, so how are you such and such? So you're going to like this.
You was a natural.
It was a natural deal, right. Correct. So here's, now watch this. I like how the NFL mimicked the combine. So this was just like when I went to the combine from LSU, except instead of working out for the Saints, Detroit, you know, Miami, you working out for, you're performing for Fox Sports, NFL Network, CBS Sports, all the major decision makers for these networks are there recruiting us. So I started to see myself slowly but surely climb up the recruiting ladder. It was almost as if I left LSU.
That's crazy.
With a low draft grade, run a crazy Chris Johnson type 40, and now I go from undrafted to a first round.
That's exactly what that sound like.
That's exactly how it felt, too, because I didn't get that type of love at the combine. First of all, I couldn't work out. I was only able to lift and interview because I had just had knee surgery from out of LSU. So this was my shot to So that went well. A lot of contacts, a lot of good relationships came out of that. A relationship, Amber Theo Harris, my homegirl, she's very instrumental on just the continuing of my career. And I can name a million people. Of course, James Brown from CBS Sports. You know, he played a major role.
Been in the game.
A very, very long time.
Been in the game.
And just, you know, for one of us, for African American.
People don't know, James Brown used to be with Fox.
Facts.
I remember James Brown when he was on Fox before he got to CBS. Because him and they ended up flip-flopping jobs.
Yeah, they did. Yeah, it's crazy.
I can think of the other guy who's now on Fox. The name is not buzzing in my head.
I'm trying to think who
the guy who's on Fox with
Keith Jackson did the NFL countdown for a long time, and I remember he got fired.
Yeah.
For whatever reason.
So for him to have all those years and still doing it, that says a lot about not only
longevity.
Longevity. And it's Brian not Gumbel. A lot of us in it. Brian Gumbel.
But Brian Gumbel did a number of different things. He didn't just do sports.
No.
He did all kind of so versatility matters in this industry as well, being able to be more entertaining, to do more. So that's what really got me in. Now, fast forward, they started to take some of us from there and have us do different things. Like, I ended up going – that's how I ended up at the NFL Network. So all of that really stemmed from the conversation. That's how I got there.
Your name ringing at that boot camp in Bowling Green, people talking, conversations happening.
Correct.
And they probably in a production meeting and say, we need to probably get Fave on there.
Yep.
You see, I saw it change as the week was progressing.
That's crazy, bro.
Because so here's what the running and the 40-yard dash and three-cone drill was there. We had to do a podcast, so a setup like this.
Right.
So I'm assuming I did well on that. We had to call a game. So they played the Super Bowl, muted everything, and I had to do the play-by-play. And my co-host did the – because he was like, play-by-play is the hardest. Now, get this. I only had did play-by-play like one time before that. Funny story, Scott, I had to get you real quick.
That's crazy.
In the beginning, my first year at CBS Sports, Scott had to use the restroom.
In the middle of the play-by-play?
This was like coming out of halftime.
A number one and number two.
Sorry, Scott. Scott was gone for about, so I had to do the play-by-play.
Scott had the red beans.
Scott had the red beans. Shout out to Scott.
Scott had the red beans.
So I had to.
He's at least 5 minutes.
That's tough.
No, it wouldn't. It was. He was gone for about 20.
God.
So
I'm halftime.
So coming out of halftime, I got to run the sponsors. This is my first year, so this segment is brought to you by G-Sportz. So Dillacell's coming out on their own 20. We have Daryl in the shotgun. So I had to run all of that and then do the color. Well, that was an excellent first down. So I thought he did a good job of just reading. So I had to back to back. Scott got back.
Go back and forth.
So that's why I got the reps from play-by-play.
That's crazy.
Because it's too different if y'all – so
you watch Joe Buck and Troy Aikman. They're totally different. You watch – well, at one point in time, Al Michaels and Chris Collinsworth.
Yeah.
They're two different things.
It's two different things. Somebody's animating us because some folks just like to listen. Like, I do this now with LSU. Like, for this away game, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go listen to a quarter in my truck. I'm going to just listen to – the radio guys talk about it and envisioning what's happening, and then I'm going to go back and watch it on TV. So you have some people that rather listen to the radio broadcast or listen to the – and they watching the play, but, okay, explain to me what just happened. So you have to nail all of that, you know. So those are one of the tests. We did the interviewing like we're doing now. And so what I noticed, this one I knew things started to work in my favor. At first I was one of the guys, so he's interviewing us. So the next day, it's like, Marlon, we want you to interview Vernon and Matt. So I started to see, like, myself kind of, like, and I felt like, wow. You know, so that's, and I'm going to tell you one thing, y'all. Those things matter because when I got back to New Orleans, regionally everything boosted up.
Yep.
Right. I got hired by WWL after that, got with iHeart after that. You know, LSU, it felt better going back. Hello, somebody. And that was the 2019 run.
Mm. Right.
So it was all of that.
Now, timing.
Timing. Now the timing.
God's timing.
Yeah, God's timing. And keep doing it. That's what my whole thing is. Y'all on episode 3 of this new season that y'all doing, when you get to episode 100, the guests going to be better. You know, y'all going to be more, you know, y'all already
fine-tuned and everything going to be moving, you know, accordingly. I do want to ask you this, though, Marlon. Let's go back in time.
There we go.
Let's go back in time. 2004, you're the number one D tackle in the country. You commit to LSU. Talk about that time and that experience during that time when you decided to commit to over programs like USC, who was a prominent program, Miami, you know, who was like the U at the time. You know, right now they're just like an umbrella, but that's no ain't no there. But talk about that time you making that decision to stay in state and commit to LSU, and talk about a little bit of that time with, you know, being on those teams and watching what's going on when you first arrive on campus.
So making the decision to go to LSU at that time had a lot to do with family and winning. Those two things mattered, especially your 17-year-old high school kid coming out of. At the time, we were a 10-0 team that lost in the first round.
And to Higgins.
Long
after you had just smashed them in week 10.
Man, that Woo. Was that story right there was so crazy. Cause you know
Hurricanes.
It was a backstory to that. It was a Found Blue Calvert deal. Like, we were supposed to play Found Blue, but that's a whole long story. Me and Coach Hank still talk about that to this day. It's crazy.
But she was hit a D.
Yes, indeed. Well, Hank, I feel like he's going to come on this show.
Yeah, we got to get Hank.
He back on the best bang now. He coming.
Yeah.
So what ended up – okay. My top five at the time was Colorado. Vance Joseph was there at the time. So the Marrero
– Was Eric Bieniemy though?
I think he was.
Eric Bieniemy was at Colorado.
Yes,
Eric Bieniemy.
Wow, I didn't know that. Yeah. Wow. Now you refresh my memory.
Yeah.
So you had Colorado visit, so I took that one, and then
because of Hank, the Hank with the connection with Vance
and
the
me,
Shaw
and me, it was me too. I had a previous relationship with
the family.
Mickey, Sammy was my teammate, and of course Vance, I would see him a lot because he would come home. So I it was familiar. Right. My cousin Thaddeus Washington is out there, so him and Sammy out there. That kind of made – I was going to take the visit. Mm-hmm. I wasn't not going to visit Colorado.
You're going
to
show them that respect.
Yes, I was doing that. That was going to happen because I knew – see, that stuff mattered to me at that time. And still, to a certain extent, familiarity. Like the fact that I've been knowing these guys for a long time. I ended up – it's a funny story. So Coach Saban would come back every week. Like, he'd come and holler at every week. him and Lance. So I had, you know, I was playing the dozens, right? After the holidays, I didn't commit. You know, I said I wanted to take one. So he came, boy, Saban came, sat down. You know, he sat down on that, he crossed that leg. You know, that once that
yeah,
leg
yeah,
crossed,
yeah, yeah,
he
yeah, yeah.
No yeah. sock on. He looking dead ass.
Hold on, what he pulled up in?
It was some tenant. I think it was a Lincoln Continental at the
gotcha,
time.
Gotcha, gotcha.
He either put up in that Lincoln or that Benz. One or two, he would swap them out, you know. He'll get, sometimes he in the back seat, you know. So.
This is 2004, y'all.
This is 2003. No, this is the beginning of 2004. This is January 2004.
Right. So before signing day was in February.
Right. So this is all, you know, I'm seeing this guy September, October, November, right. December,
right.
January. Like, only time I'm not seeing him is during dead periods.
Right.
Like, it's him and Coach Lance, and they would take turns. Right. And, you know, they would ask. So, you know, he hit me with the real. He was like, because you have to look at it like this. I still had my Miami visit to take and my USC visit to take.
Ooh.
So those are two visits I still had to take. Pete Carroll and was Coach Ed Orgeron would come down here just like they was coming.
Correct.
So and you know, this guy
was the D-line coach.
He was the D-line coach and the recruiter for this area.
And Butch Davis was still at Miami? Croker was still at Cleveland.
That's
right. So
Croker was still
at
Miami. It was Croker in Miami. Yep, you're right. So what ended up happening was that last time Saban came, he was like, well, look, Marlon, and I'm a kid, I don't know. It's a couple other recruits we're looking at. And, you know, I'm just being honest with you.
Recruiting talk.
You know, we only have this one scholarship for you now. You go take your visits. He gonna hit you with the real. Take your visits. You know, I'm not telling you to take. Oh, I committed the next week. I committed to LSU the next week.
You ain't want chances.
I ain't want chances. I committed January 16th.
Supply and demand.
Yes, yeah, so supply and demand, because I knew that's why I wanted to go. And I was a little nervous if I went to LA, I was going to like it too much. So I was like, you know, if I go there, you know, at that time, that's like paradise, right?
Right.
You know, USC rolled, because they split that year. LSU.
USC.
Yep. So they bought
national championship. Yep. They had the co-national championship.
Yep. It was co-national.
Which is crazy. I don't think. This is just me. First of all, they beat my Wolverines. I don't like that.
Right. I'm a Michigan fan, too.
They beat my Wolverines. They beat the bricks off of us. Leon Hogan roasted in that game. I'm so mad. Him and Jeremy LeSueur were just getting roasted. You know, they couldn't stop Mike Williams or Kelly Colbert to save their life. But LSU ended up playing Oklahoma in the Sugar Bowl.
Mm-hmm.
LSU actually played in an actual national championship game, because back then, it'll be the Orange Bowl.
Yep.
It'll be the Sugar Bowl. Yep. Mm-hmm. It will be the Cotton Bowl. Whichever game it was would be the national championship. LSU actually played in the game and won it. I didn't like it because both teams were ranked number one,
yeah.
And LSU actually played in the game. To me, LSU should have been being
outright.
It was different back then.
That last time you had that co-championship year.
Yeah, it was crazy. And I think Auburn and they had another co-champion year. I think by that time.
They had a co-champion year when Michigan won it.
When Michigan and Auburn?
It was Michigan and
Auburn was
undefeated. Who Michigan
year.
Split with that year?
Michigan won it. No, Michigan split that year.
Yeah, it was. When Michigan won it, we did split. Michigan did split.
Because
everybody always was saying, I don't know if it was in Nebraska.
Was this 2005? No, that was Vince.
No, this was Charles Woodson, though.
This was Charles Woodson.
Oh, so this is why.
And Brian Greasy.
I don't know if they split with Peyton.
No, it wouldn't. It would have been T-Martin.
So T-Martin won the next year. T-Martin has a national championship.
So the next year. Yeah. Right.
T-Martin
I can't remember.
Peyton lost, but yeah. T-Martin won the national championship.
I can't remember who Michigan split with that year with the
somebody.
National championship. But, yeah.
Yeah, that's
so
wild.
So if you would have took your visits, mm-hmm. and not let Saban kind of like swindle you a little bit, you think it was a chance that you would have went out of state?
I think the probability would have went up. I think I would have thought about it a little longer, and because at that time, like going to LA later on, like as a professional, I'm like, man, I should have took the visit just to kind of experience it.
Right.
But I don't regret the decision I made, because in my opinion, it was the best decision. One more championships making this decision, so it was just overall, it was just a better situation, a better setup to go to LSU. And I mean, he said some other things too that kind of. swayed me to just choose, you know, because that's why I really wanted to go. I wanted to finish my visits, but because of the Army All-American Bowl game, because of, you know.
Boy, you caught up in that Army All-American Bowl game, boy. Ooh, I remember watching it on TV.
Back then, that was what, ABC?
It ain't the same no more. It's not the same no more. It's not the same no more.
Recruiting, all that stuff changed now. Yeah. It's just a different ball game from back
then. How different you think it is now from when you, because people understand, you were the number one.
There was no social media back then.
Yeah,
you were no social media. But how different you think it is from just watching what's going on? You know, we've seen some top-rated recruits at your position that came from the state, number one D-tackles in the country. We talk about Mason Smith, who committed to LSU.
From my hometown, man. Tri Parish, man. Stand up. Sure
Tri Parish. You know Tri Parish, stand
up. Down that bayou.
You know, then you had Ishmael Sopcich, who ended up committing to Alabama when he came out. You know, Coach Hinn coached. You know, talk about some of that differences that, you know, from recruiting from when you was at then to what how it is now. What you think you see now in terms of recruiting.
I think G hit the nail on the head with the social media. That is the, like, this is the only, like, real difference right here. The distraction side of it, too. So the real piece to it is,
I agree,
social media and the distraction side of it has manipulated recruiting to a whole nother deal. See, back then, you know, the retweet or the huddle that goes viral was your letter. You would get letters from these teams, and I remember having the shoe boxes. Back then, they read about you, right? You knew about a Marlon Favorite.
That's how I knew about
Skylar
you.
Green reading,
and Friday Night Football.
Coach JT and Ed Daniels having that platform.
Phenomenal job they used to do back
then. And then, look, check this out. Back then, it was about your head coach making your VHS tape. That was the real recruiting tool. So
you know, and mailing it off.
So that's the advantage.
They did it for Reggie Bush. They locked his up.
You're right. I saw Red say, I'm back for mine. Give me my Pac-Man. Like, why you even gave it to him?
Him and Alex Smith were high school. People don't know him and Reggie Bush and Alex Smith were high school teammates.
I knew that.
They let Alex Smith stuff go. You go to Utah, you go where you want. Reggie Bush going to lock his up.
That's funny.
Pete got it.
It is different. He's going to get his, man. And that's, like I said, even with Reg, like, you had some television outlets. It was like the countdown to signing day. I remember going on that show. I remember, like, it was about being on television, people talking about you on radio. So it was really technology. So now the recruiting, they have their recruiting in the palm of their hands. They break up their own huddles, do what they have to do, send all of that stuff out. It doesn't fully eliminate the high school coach. Like, he still has to, you know, the coach when they come recruit. Hey, so what type of player is he?
Kind of kid is he in the building?
Yeah, what kind of kid, you know?
Character.
So that stuff still is in place. So that's what the younger generation need to know. And then it's also, too, Jay-Z said it on Black Album, the allure of the game. It's getting these kids, too. It's that it bit Tyrann Mathieu first. You know, I saw it take a bite at Ryan Perilou right at the cusp of this technology. And Ryan coaches our quarterbacks, you know, so we talk about this a lot. You know, you would read about and see blurry visions of this stuff. These guys, they have high definition Grammy Award winning cameras, you know, getting their mistakes. So it's that piece, you know, and it's the followings matter. And all of that. So I think, it's hard to find a really pure football player in this climate because of some of these technology advances. Really, you know, kind of it's ruffling recruiting. You know, we got the NIL deal stuff now. So a lot has changed.
Y'all know y'all had your own type of NIL at LSU. Y'all had the NIL before the NIL.
But man, y'all know y'all had Reggie Bush said it, babe. I'm gonna say it like Red said it. We had jobs. I mean, we had stipends. We had stipend checks, and, you know, in the summer, you can work. So that was really – now, I will say this. The economy was much different than it is now. So we had more affordable living than these guys. So I can't be too jealous of John Emery and those guys when they're pulling up in all these fancy cars. You know, and all this. Because if you put us in that deal, that's us. You know, so we were the top at that time of what we were doing. You know, I remember music and followers unloading on Facebook and MySpace. You know, we had the number one song in Louisiana and all this.
MySpace. Mm-hmm.
See,
he took it back.
You see how far? Those were the things that were popping, grooving on the ground. Like, people heard about us. Like, in the off season, we talked about this off at LSU. I did music and stuff. We had Jewel KCD. We were selling out the back of the trunk like Master P, right?
Right.
It was
right.
That type of environment back right. then. It just was. It was at that cusp.
What I want to touch on, because I mentor a lot of kids, preferably in my area, because I understand how important it is to have somebody advising you, understanding this process, and keep you level-headed. Mm-hmm. Faye, man, you was the number one D-tackle in the country, bro. And it's so easy to get a big head, be a prima donna, think you are above the team. Yep. Mm-hmm. Thank you the best thing since sliced bread. How were you able to keep a level head back then and stay the course? And I know your career didn't turn out like you probably wanted it to. You know, God had a plan for your life. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And you seem extremely happy the way your life is going. Right. But I see some kids that were number one at their position or number one player overall in the country, and they have a lot of mental health issues.
Oh, yeah.
As if you see them and you talk to them today. What kept you level-headed, and what kept you not, you know, having an anxiety attack or having a mental breakdown when your career didn't pan out like you thought it was going to pan out?
Okay, so a couple of those panic attacks happened later on.
At LSU or in the league?
Oh, no, in the league.
Gotcha.
Okay. In the beginning, it was family and God that kept me level-headed.
Mm-hmm.
It was the fear in God, because it was him that gave it to me. So if I'm handling this the wrong way, he could just take it.
Right.
So the fear of, you got the fear, like you said, put the fear in God in you.
Right. Right.
That in the family, the people in my ear, nobody was blowing my head up. Everybody was just like, even keel with me. Right. You know, we would see the articles and you feel it. Like I said, it's what bite people is the allure. Right, it's this fame bug, right? There's this this taste of fame, and some people get that they compare it to like a drug, so to say.
Yeah.
You know, like constantly reaching that high, like how many followers could I get? How many more people could like me? It was just not worrying about that and just let those things just take its course. So that was it. And being in the other things, like going to the studio, being around real friends. Mm-hmm. You know, shouts out to Che Fat, Tune. All my homeboys, cousins, Frank and all of them, my St. Joe's the worker friends,
mm-hmm.
and,
right.
you know, my friends from West Jeff and Shaw, like just being around cool people and just having fun, going to be the life of the party. Like, a lot of people knew me to be the life of the party. Like, oh, yeah, he played football. Like, you know, it's just,
right.
I didn't give football that much power.
Right.
Right.
Because it'll get you. It's going to turn its back on you eventually.
Wow.
You know, it's going, yeah, I didn't give it that much power. I was just thankful, you know, that my parents just, you know, we in church, I'm singing in the choir, you know, just doing good. It was about the act of service, you know. And my pops, too, he never, like, let none of that stuff get to his head. So I guess
and I think that'd be a big problem for some of them kids too, because a lot of parents try to live through their kids.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And also I think, Faye, for you, just watching you from afar before I really got to know you, I think it was you had an identity outside of Faye, the football player.
Correct.
And a lot of kids don't have an identity outside of the football player or the basketball player. Mm-hmm. And I think that's why you was able to keep a level head. But kind of touch on when you did have those mental breakdowns in the league.
All right. So for my league experience, so you leave stable LSU. I was at LSU for 5 years,
mm-hmm.
from the age of 17 to 21, right? That in that time frame, I turned 22. At that time frame, it was consistent.
Right.
Right. This would happen. Now, my playing time, I never was content on the field, so I knew the grind on the field was – I'm ready for that in any industry, right?
Right.
Because I don't mind putting in groundwork. That didn't matter. What started to really matter was not being able to have some type of level floor under me. Like, imagine living somewhere in, like, every other random – 10 to 12 minutes, the ground shaking under you. So you got to kind of – and that's what my NFL experience was. So I go undrafted to Carolina.
Yeah.
And I, you know –
I remember being at your draft party.
That's right. That's right. Man, that's throwback. That's throwback.
So hold up. You had a draft party.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You had a draft party, and you expected to get drafted.
I got two calls that day.
He had two calls today.
I got two calls that day.
It was because of the knee injury?
I think that had something to do with it, and then it had to do with where D tackles was falling off at the off the board. Like, had I came out with Glenn, I probably would have got drafted.
Timing is
everything, you know. And I look at that experience like I still trusted God through that whole situation because He led me there, so He wouldn't go take me to that part and then just leave me hanging. So that was always in my head somewhere. So the draft part and all that, now, it was humiliating, but it was fast-paced right after. Like, you didn't have no time to get in your feelings because the second the draft was over,
phone was ringing.
So my agent on the phone, he got this one on hold, that one on hold, and at that point, you got to make a decision now because
– what's the best situation?
So this team saying, I think Atlanta was like, we'll give you $7,000 to come here, and I think Cleveland was like, we'll give you $5,000. Seattle was like, we'll give you $8,000. Who else? The Raiders, it was like, we'll give you $5,000 to come out here. Like, they was just throwing different numbers. The two big numbers out there at the end of the day was Carolina and Indianapolis. The Colts, which later on ended up playing for Indianapolis.
Yeah.
But those are the two. They had 25. Both of them said 20. And then Carolina jumped to 25. And I'm like, okay, they're going to make it easy. And then Indy came with the 25. So I'm like, man, how am I going to play this? How am I going to do this? So me, Tanisha, my mom, we went in the room, we prayed. I came out. I called a scout from Carolina and said, I'm coming to Carolina. Give me my Carolina blue kicks. So
Coming to the Panthers.
So, you know, coming in the NFL that way, I'm there now, so I'm a little bit happy. I don't have the money, but I'm going to grind. I'm going to go get it. And then when that roller coaster started. So my rookie year, I got cut 5 times total, but I worked out for like 9 teams.
Right.
So you in and out of this. So I'm from Louis Armstrong to Atlanta to wherever they get me from there. Boom, 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 boom. I had to stop and work out in Atlanta, you know. Just all over the place. So that I did that consistently. So
wow.
2009, 2010, 2011. Is what, when Lil Marlon was about to be born, that's when my first nervous breakdown happened because mm-hmm. I'm like, I can't do this. So here's a funny thing. So I don't know if a lot of people notice this. So you know the guy for the Philadelphia Eagles diving? And just
Yeah.
So of course, yeah. For your
you got that as your profile picture.
That's my profile picture. That's me, right? When that was happening, I got cut the following week. Right around that time was when this nervous breakdown started to happen. See, when I dove for that play, I was really trying to get that dude. And even if I didn't get him right, I'm going to go on the sideline, and Big Red going to be like, good job, good effort.
Right.
I've never felt – so I'm a guy that ribs, so I'm okay with jokes coming back my way.
Right.
Like, I prepared for that karma, right? So when I came like on the sideline, I was off. And then the NFL recently posted the real rear view. So you see him, like, legit going, like – imagine, like, coming over the twin span and slide L and having to make a real decision. Are you going to stay on 10 or are you going to go to 59, right? Or 12 with. That dude went 59-12. I promise you I stayed on I-10. It was like that when I saw it from that deal. But it was a funny moment. but at the same time, it was funny.
Oh, it's funny.
The sideline was real, son. Like, so when I'm jogging back on the sideline, you can, like, imagine what's going through my head. Like, man. Hope nobody saw that.
They about
that.
To tear you up.
I know everybody saw that.
They about to tear you up. Especially if I know, like when I played sports, if I know you was a person that was a jokester,
yeah.
And you did something like that was like funny,
yeah.
Man, you got to get it when you come to the sideline.
Right. And
you
I had only ripped a few guys at that time. Like it was only like a couple people I was ribbing. Like,
who was on that Carolina team that was notable?
No, this was in Philly.
Who was on that Philly team that was notable?
This was the Super team.
Super Bowl team.
Namdi Asamoah.
It was Namdi Asamoah, Vic.
Oh.
It was Shady McCoy.
Oh, I know Shady got you.
I was nervous listening to that. Oh, then he was crying. So so Michael Vick was crying. So he was a funny – Andy Reid, man. So he wore glasses, right? So I pass him. He like this.
He trying to hold it in.
So I'm slowing down.
Hold it back.
Because that's the head coach. So I'm like, see, if he goes, so I'm slowing it down. He's like.
Was Jim Johnson a DC still? Or he was
no,
gone?
No, he was gone.
Probably, it was probably Schwartz.
Yeah, we had Schwartz at the time.
Yeah, that was Schwartz. That was Schwartz. Right.
Man,
right,
this dude had tears bucking down his eye. He said, like he about to cry. Like, we just won a championship.
Try to hold
like,
it in.
I never saw effort like that in my life. I bust all that. Like, the whole, once Big Red started laughing, then the whole sideline. It was a preseason game, so it wasn't nothing crazy. And I didn't get cut the next day. So that was good, because that was cut day. That was a game. So I made it another week. But it was dope. So then coming from off of that deal, I remember coming back home, having to fly back to St. Louis for my second stint with the Rams. Not now LA Rams. And when they released me, I didn't want to go nowhere else. At that point, I'm like, look, I told my agent, if somebody called, because Lil Marlon was about to be born. Mm-hmm. And I didn't want to miss that moment. And I felt like I'm not about to miss this moment for a maybe.
Right.
I told my agent, if nobody ain't talking about no upfront money, I'm not interested. So the Broncos,
you don't be thinking about it like that. All that traveling, all that commuting, all the way from your family, you don't think about it like that.
Yeah.
Hey, man, we'll bring in for $300K. Cool. All right, babe, the baby's straight. I got, you know what I'm saying? I could bring a couple G's home.
Yeah.
It wasn't like that.
That makes sense.
I got a couple $100.
Right.
Like, and see, that's a lot of things people don't know, too. The NFL really only pay like that during the football season. Unless in your contract it say elsewhere. So let's say, for instance, let's take a guy locally here. Let's say Alvin Kamara, right? Let's take his first contract. He got that guaranteed six figures, but then he had to work for the rest of that. Now he got incentives because he put the work in. He put the work in, so all that stuff worked out for him. But a lot of those guys, even the mid-rounders, if you go to the OTAs, you get a workout bonus of like $50K. You know, cats like me, and they're saying that's optional. I could not show up if I don't want to. I'm going to stay right down that Harvey couch.
Right.
So the reality is you got to go there and just get that, I don't know, $500, $700 check.
But I remember you saying on NFL Network that you kind of wished you had got hurt during the preseason because you was going to get half your salary.
Correct.
Like, versus if you just got cut.
Those feelings came when I came back. Like, when I got back, so at this point, I hadn't played my first year.
The injury reserve money, man.
The injury reserve money is real. and you don't want to – it's not like a bum insurance claim or anything like that. It's just survival. Like, y'all using me up. Clearly, I'm a camp body.
Right.
Clearly, I'm a practice squad guy, right? That's my – and I'm a role guy, too. Like, I don't have to be the superstar. I can – serve water to the room, right?
Right, right.
But at the very end of the day, that lifestyle started to become stressful because I started to see it affect my family. Because we were in a lockout. That was another thing, too. I was with the Patriots at the time when my wife told me she was pregnant. And I was about to fly back home excited because that was my first future signed contract. Mm-hmm. So every other time I would get cut at the end of the season, like, that's how I was able to – be with the Saints because Seattle didn't sign me at the end of the season. The Patriots signed me at the end of the season. When the season was over, like, all right, here's a future contract. Mm-hmm. So that I finally went back to the city to train with a little stability, like I belong to somebody. Like, I'm with the Patriots.
You with a picture between you and Albert Haynesworth. Man, you looked so small.
Yes, that dude was big.
Haynesworth, like 6'8", 6'9".
Yeah, he was, man, that dude, he was about 360 something, 6'8".
I remember.
It was another super team.
Yeah.
But it was 28 D linemen in the camp with me that year.
But I do want to touch on something before we get ready to wrap up. You talked about guys' timing, being on that Saints team in 2009 when they won a Super Bowl.
Super Bowl.
And if I'm not mistaken, you got signed like in January during the playoffs, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Man, talk about just being in that building. Being around Drew Brees, Sean Payton, Greg Williams, Bounty.
Yeah.
Shorty.
Yeah. Hello, somebody.
Hello, somebody.
Watch out there now.
But to talk about being around that time, man, and when we won the Super Bowl, because I remember, listen, I'm a diehard Saints fan. Anybody that know me knows when I came out my mama's womb, I was a Saints fan. I just, even when we were sad, I was there for the Mike Dicker days, the Jim Haslett, all of that. So nobody can ever question my fanhood of the Saints.
They traded all the picks for Ricky Williams.
Yeah. And when we won the Super Bowl that year, I ran down Bourbon Street crying. And one of my friends, I got lost in a stampede. Like, I ended up falling on the ground, and one of my friends had to grab me, and it was a mess. But
leave the hand grenades alone.
Back then, I was on Taka.
Taka, oh, I remember that.
Yeah, I was on Taka. But, man, talk about that time and your experience being around that team and Jonathan Vilma and just the greatness of that team and what you saw and what you learned from that. Right.
Well, it was a very quick experience. So I was with the Saints for about 4 weeks. So right. it was in and out. The experience, it was surreal, right? It was the quickest team I was on, but it was a surreal experience. So leading up to signing with the Saints, I didn't sign a futures with Seattle. We was just talking mm-hmm. about that. Mm-hmm. So the fact that I was available, they were able to sign me. And I know a lot of me being signing had to do, we did have conversations before the draft. I talked with Greg Williams a lot before, and the whole Saints staff. You know, with LSU, we all go to walk-ons after,
right.
and, you know, we do the luncheon after pro day. Mm-hmm. So I had a relationship. Then I went to the local Saints workout, which, again, that gave me another chance to get in front of them. And I remember Coach Billy Johnson telling me, well, we'll see how this draft go.
So I knew D-line coach, right?
D-line coach. D-line coach. So I didn't get drafted from the Saints. They wasn't even a team that called me. I think it was availability at the time.
They don't draft LSU players for some reason.
Yeah, it was.
Devery Henderson is the only one.
They drafted L. Woods.
And they didn't cut him. And L still in the league.
He just
blew him up.
He just blew
Sunday.
Him up.
Listen,
he was
cutting
yeah,
up.
Yeah,
he
was cutting up.
They drafted L. Woods.
And that's crazy. Like, we had, me and Glenn had a lot of influence on L. When he first got there.
Yeah. But, Al was like a walking time bomb.
He had a little temper at first, but he was just maturing.
Gotcha.
Like, imagine this big, gentle giant, right? So, you know, that was more of his deal. Now, I will say this about that whole experience. I had got cut 4 times before the Saints signed me.
Mm-hmm.
So, as a rookie, being on that, you know, like I told you, I did all those workouts. That was the first, like, moment, right?
Gotcha.
And it was just, I just got tired of the, it was, like I said, the surreal part was, man, y'all just won a national championship 2 years ago. Now you might win a Super Bowl with the Saints. It's your hometown.
Right.
Like, the love at that time was crazy. The day went like this. I told a story a couple times. This was a story I told to Amber. I was in Whitmer. I didn't tell us exactly where I was. I was in Whitmer at the time. And I had a number that wasn't saved in my phone. It was a 504 number. And I answered, it was Ryan Pace from the Saints.
Right.
So I'm like,
right.
What's up, Ryan?
He with the Bears now, huh?
No, Brian Pace got, with the Bears now.
No, he's not with the Bears.
He's not with the Bears.
He left the Saints, went to the Bears.
Yeah.
Yeah, as a GM, the Bears.
And the GM, the former GM.
He got fired because of the Trubisky tree.
I don't know where he at right now.
Yeah.
But see, Ryan was at LSU. Yeah. See, I originally knew Ryan. He was a GA at LSU first.
That's crazy.
Didn't know that.
So we had, he was like, what's up, big fave? Like, so he had already, like, knew me from the LSU guy.
Right.
So, and then it was so many dots that were connected in that building. My D-line coach, he was on Saban's staff, Coach Jones.
What Jones?
Coach Troy Jones.
Okay.
That was my D-line coach. But Marlon, hey! So he wasn't in Seattle with me. He was in Seattle. He was in New Orleans with me, right? So he was my assistant D-line coach on that staff, and you had Bill Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
So when I got there, and then the locker room, I had already bounced around a league to a couple of teams, so I knew some folks there already.
Right.
So I knew Meacham from the SEC,
yep. who
played against Tennessee. Yep. I knew, of course, Devery Henderson, because he always came back to visit us.
Right.
So it was just me and DeMario Presley, we played in the Army All-American Bowl game together.
Yep. Yep.
So it was so many guys that were already my homeboys on that team, plus being home, you know, the familiarity as well. So it was just, you know, I ended up being cool with just about everybody, man. It was short-lived. You know, it was a lot of political things, you know, that happened with that situation too. But it taught me a lot about the league and how things work,
mm-hmm.
you know, going through that short trip with New Orleans. And it taught me also.
How was it being around Sean Payton?
Coach was cool. The first day I signed with the Saints, he walked up to me in the line, shook my hand, said, welcome to the team. You know, coach a guy, man, at the very end of the day.
We missing him right now.
He's in 10. He slid that in
there. I had to. We missing him right now.
You know Vegas put a bet on him going to that Carolina job.
Nah, I don't think he's going to mess with it. He just did an interview with I forgot the girl name. But he just did an interview with her 2 days ago. And maybe I'm reading too much into it. Maybe I just...
Most Saints fans don't want to hear that though.
Yeah, I don't see it.
I don't think he signed with a division rival.
He really talked about the front office, the GM. Like he really got into about how that matters. Because she kept talking about you want a quarterback, you want to go somewhere where you got a quarterback. He was like that matters, but that's not really what matters. He said I care about what the owner, how the owner is, how the GM. He said me and Mickey Loomis best friends. He said me and Mickey Loomis talk every day still. I'm like, damn.
Yeah,
it's crazy.
And I just talked to Mickey about this was the beginning of no, this was middle of last year, and it surprised me. She said, "I check you out on the radio here and there," and I was like, "Man, coach, how long were you in Seattle before you came here?" He was in Seattle for like 10 years.
I remember that.
It's a lot of experience in that mm-hmm. building. And you know this being a lifelong Saints fan, the transition from 2006 to what it was before and where it is now. So, I mean, the Saints are very – they're an interesting piece, yeah. Yeah, so, but yeah.
So Fee, I need your top five high school players you either played against or seen with your own eyes.
Okay.
Top five LSU players that you seen or played with.
They got some lyrics.
Let's start some controversy. Let's start some controversy. You're going to get some texts.
All right. Ooh.
You're going to get some texts. You're going to get some DMs after this one.
Let's go.
Top five LSU. No particular order?
No particular order.
All right. Tyrann Mathieu on this list.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Kevin Fall on this list.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Two.
Man, Glenn Dorsey on this list. Mm-hmm. I'm putting Glenn on this list.
Okay.
Joe Burrow on this list.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's no particular order, but that fifth spot always tough. Because I got to think impact two. I got to think playmaking ability and impact Leonard Fournette.
Nah.
I didn't say Leonard, huh?
No.
All right. Out of them five, I only got one that I thought was going to be on your list, and that was Glenn Dorsey.
Okay.
So, you a trenches guy. Andrew Whitworth not on there?
I like the consistency in the league, but you was talking about at LSU.
Okay. He was a beast at LSU.
He was a beast. Pat P, I'm going to tell you, Joe Burrow took him off my list.
Gotcha. And okay. I guess, all right.
He did. Because if you go to my NFL Network piece, I say Pat P in my top five LSU guys.
Gotcha.
Yep.
Gotcha.
But you end up getting Joe's got to be on your list.
Yeah.
Got to be on your list.
Joe has
to be on your list.
I just thought he a trenches guy. I just knew Andrew Whitworth was going to be on there.
Andrew, and I played with Andrew for 2 years as well.
Right, and exactly. Yeah. I knew you played with him.
Like Kyle Whitworth, these are football players.
Right.
The consistency.
The epitome of a football player.
The epitome of a football player, these two guys. For you.
Him and Kyle Williams.
Kyle
stayed in the league for so long.
For one team.
Buffalo.
You know how hard that is?
Hard.
Buffalo.
That is one of the hardest things to solve hard. In the NFL, to be on one team.
Hard.
Consistently. To go through all those drafts, all those top five picks, and still be that guy. So, Kyle Williams and Andrew Whitworth, football player. He just retired last year.
Yeah. Yeah.
He came out with Scholar.
That's crazy. That's crazy when you really think about it.
And Scholar got that made pension. So he stayed long enough in the league, but that just tells
West Monroe.
You.
Like,
West Monroe, Louisiana,
I don't know if you remember when they came out here and played St. Old.
I don't know if you remember when they came out and played Shaw and we got our butt whipped. My freshman year, Whitworth beat us.
See, I don't remember that. I remember when they played St. Aul.
They beat us 35-7.
When St. Aul had Michael Franklin.
And then they beat us the next week.
Yeah.
Oh, that's what it was?
Yeah. Oh, y'all was the next week. Gotcha.
Yeah. St. Aul coach, somebody ran out the stands or something. Michael Franklin had a good game. Shouts out to the homie.
Yeah,
Michael
he got
Franklin.
Sucked up by the linebacker. I knew who that linebacker was for West Monroe. Yeah. If he don't get sucked up, St. Aul probably win that game.
Yeah, we beat John Eric, and they beat St. Aul.
Yeah.
So your top
yeah.
five right now is Joe Burrow. Glenn Dawson, no order. Tyrann Mathieu.
Correct.
Leonard Fournette. And we have
Kevin Faulk.
Kevin Faulk.
Kevin Faulk.
Gotcha.
That's
gotcha.
My five.
Gotcha. Top five high school players seen or played against.
Ooh, that is tough. Skylar Green and Sharon Carey on that list.
One, two. No particular order.
Joe McKnight on that list.
Gotcha.
I see long we got Joe.
those are like those three guys, Louisiana High School, those guys are on there.
Man, if you don't say this person
ooh.
That I got in my mind.
Oh, man, I'm
I got cause a lot of people from the West Bay gonna have something to say.
Yeah, because this is the thing. I just had this conversation a few weeks ago, and it's so hard because it's different eras too. You know right? what I'm saying? It's
no, this is your era.
This is my era.
That I'm talking about.
It's okay. I'm gonna name my two guys, but I'm very interested in seeing who because he mentioned the West Bank and everything.
First name start with a D.
Yeah. All right.
Go ahead with your next three.
Go with your next three.
Go with your next three.
I got two more.
Five. I got two more. I got two more. So, it's tough. Not quiet as it's kept. No, I can't say that person. Nope. It's hard. Okay, let me ask y'all this. And doing this list. How far are we going back?
It don't matter. Seen or played against. I've been watching high school football since 1995.
Let's go back from 99. I won't go past that point.
Because one of the guys on my – okay, cool. So if we're doing that.
That helped them out a little bit.
Yeah, that did. Because we're talking about basically our era.
Our era. That's it, 2000 on up.
I ain't going to lie, though, bro. Bruce Petty, dog. Like
– that went to Baylor?
No, Bruce Petty that went to John Eric. I'm just, he's an honorable mention.
Okay.
Like, dog, that was one heck of a player. But, shoot, man, that era, man, Thaddeus Washington on that list.
Okay.
He on that list of, like, heavy
hitters. With the Colorado.
With the Colorado, but, like, high school football players. And I'm going to probably go ahead and get my last person to, man, you got to say Ed Reed at Destrehan. In fifth spot. That's what I said. Yeah. But is Ed Reed, yeah, he in that? No. Yeah. No, is he in that range?
I think Ed Reed came out
2000.
99 or 2000.
That's my
man. How you don't have Daryl Johnson Walker on your list?
I ain't gonna lie to you.
Come on, man. Hello, somebody.
Now I'm gonna say
Daryl Johnson led the nation in picks.
He had 13 picks. Daryl Johnson.
He had 34 for his career.
I ain't gonna lie.
I see.
Because you made me, that's my guy. Now, here's the deal. Now, if we gonna tighten it like our era, Daryl is on there.
Right.
But see, because Ed was way after Daryl.
I think he graduated high school like 97. So yeah, Daryl.
Okay,
I had Daryl on that list. Daryl is an urban legend.
At the time it was him
and LaRon Landry that came out of high school together. Correct.
So I know you know if this story is true because I heard this story. I heard it from multiple people. I heard that, and I asked LaRon about it. He didn't want to admit to me or not because I played against LaRon. He in my district.
That's right.
I heard LaRon was getting ready to commit to Miami. But he didn't commit because he heard Daryl was going to Miami, so that's why he came to LSU.
Now, I do know that those two guys were paying attention to who was going to go where. Because I'll say this, LaRon was a heavier hitter.
Yeah, he was more of an in-the-box, you know, tackler. Yeah.
But Daryl had a nose for the ball.
Yes,
like,
ball
he
hawk.
He was an interception and ball hawk. That's why I'm saying, like, I have to toss up him between him and Ed Reed because – I saw some film on Ed Reed early on in high school. Mm-hmm. He didn't have the numbers as Daryl, I don't think, in his last season.
No, he didn't.
In his deal. But, I mean, Daryl, I mean, even when we played against West Jeff, O'Pair Walker, that game, man, had like seven NFL players on that team, on that field at that time. Man.
It's sad And I don't, that's no disrespect to Darryl, but it's really like I wish I could have seen what he would have done.
Yeah, man.
Me in too. College, bro. College. Like
Saban loved him, bro. He would have.
Bro. Yeah. Bro. Bro. That, he man,
was,
listen.
He's a high school.
He used to catch legend, a pick and pick 60 and then stand in the back of the end zone like this. This. Like Superman. Like Darryl.
He was the real deal, bro.
Like,
was,
bro. Come on, man.
Yeah, to see that in person in our time frame. And just always been a cool dude. Like I said, that whole Landry team. Well, Landry Walker. Landry. That whole O'Para Walker team. Right. Craig Davis on that team.
Yeah, Boston.
You had Keenan Lewis.
And that coaching staff.
Yeah, Frank Wilson.
Dave
Skip,
Johnson.
Dave Johnson.
Jaloop.
Yeah. Jaloop was on that sideline, too. That was an all-star.
Oh, that's crazy.
You know,
that all them dudes doing something Buster used to in college football.
They used to play that. Buster.
It is right now. Yeah, those guys got the numbers, like, but yeah,
it's high school.
It's a real deal.
Ain't no Buster Davis,
yeah,
man.
Yeah.
But I will say that my top five: Joe McKnight. Mm-hmm. We're going with Joe. Darryl definitely on that list. Skylar Green, Sharon Carey, and Thaddeus Washington. Yeah,
gotcha.
Thaddeus had him, and then it was a toss up because you had Travis Berry too.
He the was linebacker.
Yeah, he was
for Walker.
Him and Thaddeus numbers are like.
Well, Travis, I think with the Colorado.
Both of them with the Colorado. Him and Thad.
But now, you know, a lot of people gave.
Now, what would you put Speedy?
See, that's, Speedy way down the line, though. Speedy way down the line.
We really had to stay in our era. That's why I pulled right. Ed out. But yeah, man,
Speedy way down the line.
Speedy with Speedy. Lennon and all of them.
Yeah, you know. yeah. Speedy, you know, you could talk about Landon Collins.
Yeah, it's, that's why I say how far we gonna go with this. It's
different
eras.
Because I came out during COVID. You know, we couldn't go nowhere. I started a ruckus on social media. I came out with my top 25 high school players I ever seen. And, man, I was getting so.
I remember that, yeah.
Boy, people was coming at me left and right like, man, what you.
I want them to challenge mine. And like I said, that's why I'm glad
we going to make it a snippet.
In that era. And like Joe, like rest in peace, my homie Joe. He sat right on the cusp of would have been a newer era with those next high school.
He was, everybody felt like he was going to be the next Reggie Bush.
Yeah.
That's what everybody. That's how everybody felt.
Joe was definitely in that list, man. Joe McKnight was special at John Curtis, man. You know, when you watch him play, you're just like, how can you move like that?
Electrifying.
Not just the offense. I mean, he played safety. He was like, man, it didn't matter.
Yeah. And I think we'll put him on the map too when they went and played Hoover, and Hoover had them. They was like getting a docuseries with Hoover. Yeah. And Joe, they went to Hoover.
Yeah.
Man, Joe had like 280 yards all purpose. Scored like four touchdowns. Bro, he looked like he was in a park ball game. That's how cold he was. You know what I'm saying? Lord rest his soul. Man, Faye. Finally got you on here.
Man, we got you on here, man.
Big Faye, man. Got him on here, man. Appreciate you coming on here, man. Giving us some good content. You know, because what me and Fred and Big Hen talked about was the reason why we wanted to get to this platform, because when kids and parents watch this podcast, they're going to take something from this podcast and use it. You know, they might have a son or a nephew or a godchild that they can take.
Even a
this
daughter.
Take this information and relay it to them. Yeah. And we want to be entertaining, but also we want to be educational and give people a reason to want to watch this show and have substance when they watch this show. And I knew having you on here, you know, with your recruiting stories and, you know, the mental health side of it and your journey with the broadcasting and your football career, man, you had a hell of a journey, man. And I just appreciate you coming on, man. We got to get you back on.
In the near future. Bro. Man, you know, I appreciate y'all for having me on here, using this platform to tell my story and things going on. Absolutely, man. Thank y'all, bro.
Yep.
Real talk.
No problem. Yep. Listen, man, y'all tune in. This is episode 3. The Fan View Podcast. Listen, with G-Sportz, that boy Fred, Marlon Favorite in the building, man. Listen, y'all get locked and get tuned in. Listen, we appreciate having you, bro.
Subscribe. Share to a friend. Tell that friend to share. It's on it, Papa, man.
Subscribe.
Hello, somebody.
Like. Share. More importantly, watch. Hello, somebody.
There you go.
Listen, that's Fan View Podcast episode 3, man. Listen, y'all stay tuned and stay locked in, man. We'll see y'all next time. But
whew.
Faye dropping gems.
Hello.
We knew that.
he knew we was knew coming.